Nou, dank jullie wel dat ik hier mag zijn en dat ik hier leuk mijn speech kan houden. No, but you were confused, didn't you? Well, that's also when you're talking to children and you do that with an adult mindset, they don't understand you. So we have to shift our thinking into into the children's language. I give you my overview of the presentation because I first want to take you on a journey to see what sport can be and should not be. So I want to change your mindset at the end of this speech, and I hope that you will agree with me that it's an absolute necessity to create a pedagogical climate when we coach children. It's not there yet in sport, because I know a lot of sport clubs in the Netherlands and all over the world, they don't create pedagogical climates, and it is a must. So I hope you will join the presentation, and I hope I can influence your mindset to do so. So what can sport be? There are two phases of sport. You already heard, I also investigate the safe part of sport. We can win and lose with sport, and therefore we need a pedagogical sports climate. So we can explain that by four pillars, but that's just theoretical explanation. So the role of the coach and the acquired competences, they will make the pedagogical climate. So you are the first responsible for a pedagogical climate. A coach will impact more young people in a year than the average person does in a lifetime. So you are a great influence on each life of the child. So you have influence. Be aware that you influence, if you know it or not, you are always of influence. At the moment you teach, at the moment you coach, you are of influence. In the Netherlands, we have a new strategy because we say sport can be a very good thing for society. We made they are Dutch fact sheets, and we say we can win a lot with sport. It's good for health, it's good for education, it's good for national pride, it's good for innovation, social inclusion. And also the EU, our ministers, that's also why we got this project, are aware of the fact that to create more awareness of the added value of these transversal skills to integrate to their positive outcomes in national and European policies and strategies. They want to use sports for society. Sports is a good tool to skill children to have positive effects on society. So, sport also has an enormous reach. These are the numbers from the Netherlands. We have 2.4 million children, in which 1.6 million are involved in a sport club. So, organized sports has a huge responsibility for children, because they get a lot of children in their clubs. It's important to know that it's a lot of children. And we also say, of course, we are the believers. We know sport can help children grow into social behavior, working together, health, social integration, dealing with winning and losing, learning, fair play, team spirit, self-esteem, responsibility. Sport can do all. But there is a condition. Sport in itself is not social. Sport in itself is not healthy. There's always the opposite part. So you have to recognize that also for the positive effects of sport, you have to do something. It's not there in itself. So sport has two phases. Because if you only see the positive part, then you don't recognize that there also is a bad part. Or even a very ugly part. We all know that also sport is part of society, so what happens in society also comes to the sports sector. We had this huge Me Too discussion. It started in England with one football player who comes out, and then everybody was shocked because it was soccer. Within the Netherlands we also have a lot of media attention. Sorry, they are in Dutch, we translate though. For stories, for sexual abuse, and they also want to go into why is it happening? Why can that be? And do we tolerate this? So there was a lot of discussion and big research in the Netherlands by a commission installed by the government, so to see what is happening there and what do we do about it. And it's not only about sexual abuse. We also saw, we had a major incident by the death of an arbiter. He was punished by the bystanders. Teammates, sexual intimidation, and of course the trainer coach that also videoing in the locker rooms. So this is a massive point of attention, and it's in the media. And then you think, is it only, are this the single cases? Are there a lot of cases like that? So what are the figures saying? So we did a big research, because the prevalence numbers are not clear yet. We did a big research within the Dutch-speaking part of Belgium, Flanders, and Holland, with 4,000 people who filled in questionnaires about their experience in the period before they were 18, so in the youth sport experience, and they were now 18 years and old. And we asked them, what were your experiences? But you can look at the numbers here, because it's psychological abuse, physical abuse, or sexual abuse. The good part of this slide is the green part. So it's still, the green part is the most experience in sports. So still, sports is a very good thing to do. But then if you look at the red and the black numbers, together they represent these numbers. And if you look at the experiences, then you see that 13% of the children have experienced sexual intimidation. That is a lot. It's one out of more than 10 children that experience sexual abuse. One out of 10 also physically abused. We sometimes see those things within the Chinese sport areas where they put the children in the spreads and they scream. And the most targeting number is the bullying part, the intimidation part. The yelling part is the psychological abuse. And then it's 25% of the children. If you look at the numbers in the Netherlands, and you have 1.6 million children, and 25% of that, cannot do that scientifically, but then you talk about 400,000 children that's facing psychological abuse, the bullying, the top-down coach telling you have to do this, you have to do that. So there are big numbers. And if you look a bit deeper, the numbers you saw in the other slide were the first one. There's also a higher risk for special groups. So the immigrants have a higher risk of abuse. The not heterosexuals have a higher risk of abuse. The elite sporters have a high risk of abuse. And the handicapped have the highest risk of abuse. So if you teach special kids, please remember those, because they have a higher risk. And we all have seen examples of it in the media, covered by stories that say it happens. The good part for you guys is that you're not only the perpetrator, because they thought, oh, the coach is the perpetrator. And we did a lot of research with helplines, and in a helpline somebody comes there and tells, I have an abuse, and it's always the adult, and mostly it was the coach. Our research now shows that the perpetrator can be the teammates, so the peers, the yellow bar, can be the coach, and can be others, like the material man, the physiotherapy. You saw the case in America with the doctor. Can also be bystanders. So everybody can be a perpetrator. If I talk to clubs in the Netherlands and they say, well, we know all people. We can trust them. And then I said, okay, but that also can be a perpetrator. Because we had this huge case with a handicapped children, and the perpetrator was the coach, a very nice, gentle coach talking, coming home with the children, and he was the perpetrator. So a nice person can also be a perpetrator. It's the thing in which they are grooming. For you as coaches, the bar with abuse and the yellow high bar, that it's the teammates, makes that you have to go into group dynamic. So if you have you teach a team, group dynamics is a very important issue to look at if you are with children, because the bullying is done by the teammates the most. So you have the responsibility to see that it's not there, the bullying. I teach at school, and then I said to my class, I said, if you are going to bully, I can bully you. And I'm much better than that, so we don't bully. So they did it. I convinced them. So in the end, it's always the question, do we win or do we lose with sport? And what's there the answer? We are researchers, so we look for scientific proof. And there is a great scientific proof that the key for enhance the positive effects and diminish the negative effects, that's the same key. And it is that sport requires a context which fits with the development of the child. And that's what pedagogy is about. It's about the child's development. And it's the key to create the positive effects of sport and diminish at the same time the negative effects. So it's a very great tool to use. So sport needs a pedagogical climate, because we have responsibility for all the children and not only the best. And again, we are scientific researchers. We come to a problem, because if you want to define a pedagogical climate, so you can also see what we should do in practice, we look at the scientific definition, and then it's not unambiguous. And that's also because of language. In the Netherlands, we have other words than the Anglophile language has. So there are synonyms for education, teaching, instructions, and didactics. Didactics, in our view, is not the same as pedagogical, because then you only look at what you're doing. We are also looking at how we're doing. So in our view, the term pedagogical is understood in the child development sense of the word, and then rather than in the more amplified uses related to teaching strategies. So child development is the key. Then we want to find the sports climate from a pedagogical view, and we have the same problem. And that's also because different researchers have different backgrounds and use different theories. So in this we see that pedagogical climate relate to an ethical climate, a motivational climate, a social moral climate, and a caring climate. Do we choose one climate or do we define another one? So we did a large literature review, and we said we make a known definition of a pedagogical climate, because we want to face all the facts that help children. So we came up with 4 pillars. You can recognize them. It's a development-oriented climate, a caring climate, a motivational climate, and of course, a safe social climate. It's about children, and these are the theoretical pillars, because in practice, they will go fluently in together. But to understand the necessity of a pedagogical climate, we divide them in 4 pillars. So the first pillar, the development-oriented climate, is a personal and social development. It's not only about the physical development, so teaching sport and being more motor educated, but also personal and social development. We have a holistic view, and you want to reach the whole child. And in that, the target of pedagogy is to create autonomous people. They have, they can choose themselves what they do. It's the highest goal of pedagogy. So the focus is on autonomy and self-regulation. Self-regulation is one of the biggest things athletes need to reach elite level. So this is also necessary for elite sport. And the exercise material is offered in an appropriate structure. It's Chris will show you an example of the 2-2 soccer play for young children, or 3-3. That means that the game is transferred to how children experience the sports. We need to address that. You need different things, and it differs from age group to age group. So in this view, children first, sports second. This is a very important thing, because if you say, I agree, children first, sports second, then all your decisions will be different. Because if you look at a sports game and you are a coach with a young group, and you say at the end and you are losing, what do you do? If you say, child first, sport second. If you are losing, but you are see all the children want to have fun, also in the competition, and you have this relation system, you have to keep to your relation system, and then you lose, but they played a very nice game, and you were not on the result of winning. So it has consequences, how do you look to your sports, and in children first, you favor always the child, and not the result, and not the win. The Karen climate, it's about the moral atmosphere. How do you look at fair play? I was this week I was at a sport club and I was looking at coaches, and there was one coach teaching little kids, and he was shouting to one of the kids, give him a paw, he's running. I said, give him a paw? Is this fair play? It's what you do at elite sport and what you see at the top level. Hold him at your shirt. He said, hold him at your shirt. He said, what is he teaching? So this is about what do you say to younger in the moral atmosphere, in the fair play thought, respectful. So the focus is on communication and interaction. What do you say? What do you do? What do you send with your body language? And it's essential is the relationship between the coach and the pupils. You are the essential part of a pedagogical climate. You create the pedagogical climate. You as the adult in front of the group are responsible for the ethical climate, for the caring climate. So your moral compass guides the children. Big responsibility. It's up to you. And you care about all children, not only the elite ones, the better ones, but also the ones that not that good, or the ones that have a bad mood at one day. At the moment, there's a child yelling at you at school. Maybe you can ask him, why are you so angry? Because it can be that his parents are in a divorce, and it has nothing to do with sport. But if you only react on that he is angry and that you don't like it, then it's not a caring climate. So if you care for children, you want to understand the children. And you care about all. The motivational climate, it's, I think, the climate you know best, because that's where you teach. It's stimulating and learning. It's focused on the fun factor, and you do that by creating successful experience that can be attributed to one's own capacity. you're not coaching on the result for winning, but you're coaching on the process. You are on the growing, on the development. You can go with the children. So it's process oriented. And within the motivational climbing, you maybe all know the theory of Daisy and Ryan. And they say the children's basic needs are autonomy, competence, and relationship. And that is what, when they become intrinsic motivated to stay in sport, to become good in sport, and to be, have fun in sport. But you already see that if you look at those words, they also, including in the caring climate and in the developmental oriented climate. So, important point. And then, of course, the safe social climate. I think the numbers I just mentioned speak for itself, that it's needed that we have attention for the safe sport environment and focus on preventing unacceptable behavior. Within your group, you are responsible for doing that. So take responsibility to prevent unacceptable behavior. You can talk about the children with it. You have your own attitude towards them. And you have to realize that an optimal learning outcome is not possible when children feel unsafe. This has something to do with all your things in your head and the stuff that's running there that block your learning capacity at the moment you feel unsafe. Neurologically, scientific evidence that if you want your athletes to become great and to become better, they need a learning environment that's safe. So child protection, safeguarding youth sport is one big topic. So, nicely, thoroughly explained all the pillars. And what does that mean in practice? Well, I first say it's a bigger problem because you cannot do it alone. If you want to create a pedagogical climate within a sport, you have a multi-level approach. You need the policymakers, locally, nationally, internationally. So, I'm lucky that I also work at NOC-NSF and can influence them on this macro level to include the pedagogical climate within their policy and say youth sport needs special attention because they give money to the clubs and can say you have to do something. Also, the sport clubs need to adapt the fact that they want to create for youth sport special circumstances. Children are not mini adults, so they need something else. So also parents, referees and administrators should be educated in the necessity of a pedagogical climate. I think you all know the parents shouting at the sideline towards their children and bullying at the sideline. So also there is a big problem. The soccer in the Netherlands has a very nice experiment. The youngest children, they play soccer on the field and they said to the parents, you have to be 20 meters from the field and you cannot interfere with the soccer. The soccer and the fun for the children run up and the parents stay calm and said, oh, it's fun. So children can do it on their own, very good. So they don't need shouting parents. And then of course, you, the micro level, there where you teach, you are an important part together with the athletes. You also can educate the athletes and empower them and give them saying. I think you know now you are the center of the pedagogical climate. So what's your role? To become a pedagogical climate, I cannot say you what to do, because you are all experienced, are on different levels, you have your own character. So it's your way to find out which instrument am I? What can I do good? What can I do bad? So can you build relationships? What do I do with dialogue and conversation? I'm a good listener. Can I give compliments? So to become a good coach and to be a great coach, look yourself in the mirror and ask yourself, what kind of coach am I? So do you have the right questions? From a pedagogical perspective, the right questions to ask is, do I know the young people I coach? Do I know what moves them? Are my directions age appropriate? Is my exercise material buildup age appropriate? Is my focus on fun and learning? Coach I process oriented? Do I try to control players or strengthen their empowerment? Do I give too much feedback? Do I ask too few questions? Do I provide social security? It's a lot about the how you coach. And you can learn that to become aware of where you are. Are you unconscious incompetent or are you conscious incompetent? Do you feel that you have to learn something? So then you are conscious competent if you have learned how to deal with a pedagogical climate. And the great coaches, the one you always say, wow, that's a great coach. That are the unconscious competence, but that comes with experience, or some guys are naturally coaches that do the right thing. But you need experience to come in the unconscious competence, because then you're doing it by yourself. So the thing we want to address here is that you become conscious competent. There is where learning starts. For the iCoach Kids, we also did a very great literature review, and one of the things we came up with is that reflecting and learning is a very important competence for coaches. The more the coaches, the expert and successful coaches continuously reflect on their practice with accent on their own performance instead of the athlete performance. So you ask yourself, what can I do better so that my athlete performs better? And there are different models of reflection, so there's not one method to learn you how to reflect. And for effective reflections, you should have an open mind. And so you can adapt to the values that are needed for the children. And then still you become great coach. We have a handout for made up with the iCoach Kids, the pledge. But I just show it because tomorrow Sergio will elaborate on this totally, so then you get more information and more knowledge. And still, the working environment will be stubborn. You always face problems, you always face problem children, so you have to go alone. So you have to learn. I have a nice movie, because we in the Netherlands, all the scientific knowledge we transfer into a practical booklet for coaches, so that they also know what to do in the field. But it's 6 minutes. Do you want to see this? It's Dutch, but English spoken. So that's what you see, that the theoretical part goes into practice, but then differs. So the four insights are not the four pillars, but it's the practical idea how to deal with the four pillars in practice.
Four insights into coach. My name is Guillaume Vermeer. Just like you, I'm a coach. I really enjoy working with my group and seeing them develop, but I do sometimes run into issues, like making agreements and at the same time giving the athletes enough space and freedom to develop. I want us to get results, but what effect does that have on their enjoyment? And when I work with the whole group, how do I keep giving enough attention to individuals? I can give them all sorts of instructions, but how can I make sure they're able to make their own decisions correctly? Like many coaches, I'm still searching for the right balance, and every coach can use a little help with that. That's why I want to share four insights with you that will help both me and our group to develop further and enjoy our sport even more. Let's go back to the start. Why did you become a coach in the first place? What makes it so enjoyable to do? I really enjoy seeing athletes get the best out of themselves and seeing their perseverance and self-confidence grow. That gives me a lot of hope. When playing sports, people don't just learn about their sport, but develop in many other areas as well. How do you work and play together? How do you handle the diversity? How do you manage the difference between winning and losing? Whether you want to or not, a coach plays an important role in the development of athletes. If as a coach you show importance and officials respect, then your athletes will do the same. If you treat everyone as equals, then the athletes will follow your example. And when your sports will likely lose, your athletes will learn to do that as well. This seems like common sense, but it's not that easy. Coaches can be confronted with unexpected circumstances, and then you have to search for and find the correct solution. Something that has helped me as a coach is to keep my focus on organization, encouragement, personal coaching, and transfer of responsibility. Let's have a more in-depth look at this. Start off with organization, because this gives athletes a structure to work with. To support this, I use agree, declare, and query. In your role as coach, you must be sure to declare what you expect from your athletes. If you make clear agreements with each other, then everyone knows what is expected of them. What time, where, who, how long, simple, practical details. This can also be used for behavior within the group and towards other groups. What is acceptable behavior and what is not? And don't forget to include the parents. What is their role during training or competition? When you're getting started, organization can take time, but it will give everyone a clear picture of what is expected, and that will save time later. Because of the agreements and organization, everyone should be aware of what is expected of them, and this will also provide space to move and develop. And when someone does not adhere to the agreements, we can query their behavior by referring to the agreements that were made earlier. Encouragement refers to positive coaching of the athletes and to giving tangible and honest compliments. Instead of focusing purely on the result of the act, it's preferable to show your appreciation for the personal development of the athletes. That is why giving compliments for the application or performance of a specific task can be so rewarding. Use tips or tasks to package a development plan, or better still, start off with a compliment before addressing development areas. In this way, both the athletes and the coach will enjoy their sport more, and this will also increase your chances of winning. When using personal coaching for individual athletes, there are two important aspects to remember. Every athlete wants to be noticed and recognized, and every athlete has a personal level to which your support must be adjusted. However difficult it might be within a busy group, give each individual the attention and motivation they need and deserve. This can be found in small things, for example, by using the athlete's name or asking how they are getting along at school. Keep in mind the different levels of the individual athletes and adjust your instruction accordingly. In this way, each athlete can get the best out of him or herself. During transfer of responsibility, the athlete learns to take responsibility for the realization of his or her personal goals. How can you achieve this? In practice, this means giving less instruction and advice and using more open questions to invite the athlete to participate in his or her own learning process. Hold off on giving feedback and allow the athlete to make choices. And reward athletes for the choices they make and the options they take. And what do you get from this? Athletes who achieve their personal goals, develop more quickly, and perform better. That is easier said than done. But let's give it a try. The good news is, everyone can go to work using these insights. It could be that you are stronger in one facet than another. You may be good at making agreements, but struggle with giving compliments. Perhaps you are good at adjusting your instruction and coaching to suit the level of the individual athlete, but find it more difficult to give athletes the space to find their own solutions. Come on, give it a try, and remember to self-reflect. Ask yourself, what can I do to become an even better coach? What do What are your next steps? The athletes will develop in new areas, and so will you. The athletes will enjoy their sport more, and so will you.
To help you to find your own path, because you are all autonomous coaches and you have to find your own path to become a great coach, we did iCoach Kids and we developed some different materials that can help you to become this great coach. So look at our website. The MOOCs are coming, very nice MOOCs with great videos. And remember, you are a coach. Because, and I am a coach because of the kids and the passion I have for the sport itself. There is no other feeling quite like helping young athletes further develop their natural persistence, determination, discipline, dedication, resilience, work ethic, heart, leadership skills, connection with and respect for others, not only in competition, but in life. Thank you for your effort. From the video? Yeah. Positive coaching. Yeah.
I think reading is about teaching.
We always say that positive coaching is about only give positive confidence, but that's not. Positive coaching is that you have amount of feedback that's more positive than negative. So you can say you did that wrong, but you still have to do that on the process and not on the result. And all scientific evidence says if you are coaching on the process, keep the positive feedback and give them a lot of positive attention, the performance will go up. Because I talk also to the elite coaches within our LOCNSF, and they all say, well, this positive coaching, that's soft. We don't create winners, because we need this hard struggle for winning. I said, well, the evidence is, the research evidence is showing the opposite. But then the coaches are not willingly doing something else, because they always did that. And they still have this view in mind that the drilling coaching and the top-down coaching makes the Olympic athletes. And that's not the case. Because all the evidence shows that the process-oriented motivational climate, the positive coaching, creates better performance. And you create better persons. with the top-down coaching, you can create, of course, Olympic athletes. It's proven. But then you break down the person. So with positive coaching, with the motivational climate, you create and better persons and a better performance. So that's why we also say to the elite coaches, it's not soft. It's a different way of coaching. But you can say, of course, to a child that you did it wrong this time. Of course, but not all the time, and not always with you're bad and you have no attitude, or it's you have to stay with your comments on the task and not on the person. So I hope that answers your question.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you for your presentation. I just want to add some comments. Well, you mentioned that how important it is to build conscious, competent children and young athletes. And I just wanted to highlight is how important it is to concentrate on what are those aspects and defects and instructions through they can understand competency, they can sense competency, because this is the detail where the level ends, and I believe. And how important it is that those components that make them conscious can pretty much be the same components that make them competent through that. And that's what I wanted to highlight.
Great comments.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I agree totally.
I'm currently in school in New York, America, so very competitive, and in the sports, and I think a lot of you are saying that in a lot of sports over there is not there at all. But I'm very much from the CEA, we even have an education with a separate shared coach, education coach for just children's coaches, and I've done a few years ago. Come back to your pedagogy and design. Whenever you first started those pedagogy discussions and trying to implement those things and implement those plans in the clubs and sport organizations, how long did it take for coaches to get a sense of utilizing and coaching from possibly changing their mindset? So that's what I'm trying to do over there, but
well, nice question, because if you want to target a pedagogy climate, you want a change. So we have to change culture. And I started my professorship 4 years ago, and then I talked to MCNSF and all the club about sports pedagogy, and they were only talking about safe sport climate, but then you do things to do the negative part, and you have rules and legislation, but for the positive part, they did nothing. So I then talked to them, and talked to them, and talked to them, and talked to them. So, and I create the snowball method, with more people that talk with me, and talk with me, and